In 1973, the Australian Schools Commission recommended the setting up of a funding program for disadvantaged schools. In Victoria, this is known as the Supplementary Grants Program. Supplementary grants aim to provide greater equality of opportunity so that schooling may be relevant, enjoyable, and fruitful in itself, not only preparation for later life. The program also encourages schools in disadvantaged areas to become closer to parents and local communities. There is no simple formula. Teachers are encouraged to develop programs that are particularly suited to the needs of their children. An example of this is Lyndall Hall, a subschool of Brunswick East High, where an alternative approach is being funded by the Supplementary Grants Program. The Northern Metropolitan region covers the municipalities of Preston, Coburg, Northcote, Broadmeadows, Whittlesea, Heidelberg, and Eltham. 79 schools have been classified as disadvantaged in this region. When making this classification, the program took into account factors such as the socio-economic status of the children's parents, the numbers of Aboriginal and migrant children, and the number of single-parent families in the school. Research indicates that there is a strong link between these sort of factors and poor educational performance. Schools are asked to locate the particular area of educational disadvantage confronting their students. In setting up programs, program leaders are urged to devise activities that aim to overcome these problem areas.
Supplementary grants, I think, has been the means by which we came to terms financially with trying to create something for a very disadvantaged school. Northcote High School, as you may know, is largely a migrant school. It has about 85% of boys who are from non-English speaking homes. And, well, all the usual problems of migrant schools apply. But we had the added one of having to start from scratch. What were we going to come up with in terms of a maths program? And that was the beginning of it. There are a lot of structural domestic problems we can't solve in a school, I'm the first to admit that. But at least we can stop some of the effects of them carrying into the school. Five areas we found we wanted to attempt to come to terms with were, one, the problems of language, fairly obvious one, but very real. Secondly, the problem of the child who has specific area deficiencies. That is, he's missed out in primary school, his parents have gone home to Greece for 2 years, all sorts of things have happened that have interrupted his learning program. Thirdly, the child who fails to achieve because he cannot work at the class speed. Given more time, he could do the work, but usually he can't cope. He gets further and further behind, but not for reasons of intelligence. Then the more thorny ones, like the social and personal problems that the children had. We found a very high correlation, very high connection between children who had difficulties at home, no father, parents out of work, social distress, and children who just could not, for understandable reasons, see any point in doing mathematics at school when you've got all these other problems hanging over your head. So we felt, look, until we can understand, at least sympathise with these children, and see them as real people who are worth something, their attitude to mathematics in particular was going to be very negative. In terms of the content of what we're trying to do, we work in two different directions. David Bell, our teacher aide, works with about 20% of our students in small groups. What applies for everyone is the Math Centre, which operates at lunchtimes, at recesses and after school. And here's where the interaction comes about between the children, the staff and the neighbourhood. This began about 2 years ago as a voluntary group of three children with one fish tank and a few fish. It's now grown to a membership, a financial membership of 145 students who engage in different kinds of activities that they have proposed are important to them. And so we have developed 12 or 14 different operations now under the umbrella of the Math Centre. We do things like electronics, we do photography, we do beekeeping of all things, we study tropical fish, we have an astronomy unit that's connected with the ASV, we have a school chess team we've developed here, and very good chess players they are too. Now, you know, the interests go on and on and on, but they're organised by the children. It's a student management program. So I find this is a chance for the kids to be themselves, to organise themselves, and we do get good input from community people who can contribute things that we as a staff can't.
The decision to determine priorities, to develop appropriate programs, and select the resources to support the programs has always been the ultimate responsibility of the school. This process begins when teachers identify an area of disadvantage within their school. At this stage, field consultants can assist teachers in developing program suggestions to deal with the perceived disadvantage. Together, they design a program to fit into the scheme of the school. Once a program is established, it is submitted to the school's proposal committee. This committee represents parents, members of the school staff and administration who analyze the school situation, determine educational priorities, and develop a documented working process that provides for the needs of the children. A submission is made to an area committee. These committees exist in each region to service groups of schools and have the responsibility in making final program funding decisions. A subcommittee representing the area committee is sent to the school to discuss the proposal and interview teachers concerned with the program. Then, if the program is considered relevant, worthwhile, and feasible, the school will be assisted financially. Each year, supplementary grants money is given to the states by federal government on the recommendation of the school's commission. In 1978, $2.4 million, more than a third of Victoria's $6.2 million, went to the northern region. Area committees are required to fund programs which they consider to be of quality. The committee requires evidence that new initiatives in curriculum planning are based on thoroughly researched needs of children and the demands of the school community.
To see that all the zoo animals were properly taken care of. After pulling Chester's tooth, Dr. Cook went to see the new zebras. They were cooped up in a holding pen.
"Will you be riding the bike too?" the policeman said to me. I laughed. "I'll be sitting on the back," I said. "Rod has a leg. I'll let it go with their old bike. Then we'll have to get two helmets," I said. "Liz," Rod said.
A basic aim is to establish whether or not funding has had any effect on the educational outcomes of the children. This demands that schools systematically evaluate their programs and make honest judgments about the real value of what they are doing.
Where you are now, or
parental and community involvement is vital to making both real curriculum decisions and in achieving success with many new educational programs. Parent groups provide sources of mutual support, education and companionship for themselves and the children. They provide feelings of belonging to a community with the chance of sharing information and experiences. They can give a greater understanding of what being a parent is all about.
We have several different areas of problems and disadvantage. One, of course, is a physical one. When you first walk in, the very first sight that meets you is the high security fence, which is the result of a high degree of vandalism over a number of years, and the lack of any garden or any other physical feature that is pleasant to the eye. A second area is the degree of frustration that greets both staff and children. This is, I think, is a result of much of the previous experiences of parents and children at schools, and it causes a great deal of concern to a number of us. This includes, of course, the number of very inexperienced and young teachers who have been through this school over a long period of time, and the difficulty that the school has had in obtaining experienced and senior staff members. A third area has to do with the area itself. Most of the children here miss out very badly on background experience, and this is very notable in the language area. Through the matter of large families, both parents working, and of course a number of parents being unable to obtain jobs, it's very difficult for children to be able to go on the normal types of outings and excursions that families frequently have over a weekend. This area then was something that was a very strong need that we could immediately make use of supplementary grants to overcome. The staff have been very well represented in development of programs and the providing materials and ideas. Early in the supplementary grants program, of course, nobody had a great deal of experience, and of course the school was staffed largely with inexperienced teachers who needed to be able to develop their own ideas on education and develop their own teaching strategies and educational ideas. As the program has progressed, so have the teachers, and they've been perhaps the greatest recipients of benefit from the supplementary grants program. We expect three results from the camping program. The first is you take the children and put them into a specific situation where, through their own initiative and their own abilities and the skills that they've learned, to have a degree of success and self-realisation which should carry through to them in other situations. We also hope that through the camping program we can get a higher degree of parental involvement, support for things that are happening in the school, and support too for the children in these things. The third thing, of course, is a very simple one, and this is presenting to the children something in most cases totally new to them, and perhaps even opening up an area of recreation that should last them through the rest of their life.
The supplementary grant scheme should not be seen as a means of propping up needy schools with some financial assistance. It must be seen as a part of a national action research program where every teacher plays a vital role in contributing to its ultimate success. Programs can be viewed as a springboard for many other educational initiatives which may help to make schooling a socially and educationally rewarding experience for our clients, the children.